Good morning. So it is humorous to me how things come around full circle to remind you and humble you is I have been having all kinds of problems with my voice for the last 2 weeks. So I'm always clearing my throat like now. And that can be so annoying. Well, when I was young, and I was telling Jenny and Eldora this story, is that we had a pastor, his name was Pastor Fleck. Well, he was always clearing his throat, so all of us kids quickly named him Pastor Phlegm. So now, every time I clear my throat, I'm thinking Pastor Fleck is laughing. I'll tell you, some of those things come back to get you, don't they? Well, we're going to be finishing up the series in the parables. This has been a great challenge to me. This is part six, and this is the end. There's something about the parables that are so powerful. Because we call them, they're stories that surprise. They are really, honestly, apocalyptic type literature in the sense that they unveil Jesus Christ and the kingdom right under the nose of Caesar. And there they are, powerful. But there is always the plea from Jesus, those who have ears to hear, let them hear. It takes a little bit of digging in to get what's happening because we've seen a few times where Jesus he's had to pull the disciples apart and they're like, please explain this to us. And he does and gives us a great insight. Of course, Matthew is writing his gospel on the other side of Easter where Jesus is alive, has resurrected, and ascended to the right hand of the Father, where he is, in fact, the King. And we have seen in the parables the Son of Man, the fulfillment of Daniel 7, where the Son of Man ascended in a cloud in God's glory, his Shekinah glory, to the right hand of the Ancient of Days to take his throne. And we know that happened at the resurrection and then ascension. Picture is there, and Jesus was telling the disciples, he was telling us all about the kingdom. So we come to the end here of this little series, and I call it the greatness of the kingdom, because it is this kind of conclusion where Jesus gives us these parables that really reveal the greatness of just how valuable the kingdom really is and the King. So I wanted to give you a little insight here into the Gospel of Matthew, because at the end of this part six, we come to another one of five big divisions in the Gospel of Matthew. And these are all worded very, very much the same, as it says in verse 53 of 13, when Jesus had finished these parables. It is always, you can look this up, when Jesus has finished, and then he moves on to the next chapter in his ministry. It's how Matthew lays this out. So there are some areas that are really highlighted by Matthew. Many think that it reflects that Matthew sees Jesus as the fulfillment of the prophet to come that Moses talked about and the five books of the law as completed in the gospel, these five divisions. So I found that as insightful as you study the gospels and you see these things, that Matthew, he laid the gospel out. Let's face it, none of us can tell Can you imagine what that book would look like? And can you imagine how boring it would be? Now, some people attempt this on Facebook. I don't care what you had for breakfast. So some people do. I mean, there was a whole series called 24, right, on television, where it tried to just take literally a 24-hour period, and they made a whole series out of it, of breaking it down hour by hour and hour. I mean, think about, honestly, if you want to be detailed, everything you could say. Well, the gospel writers couldn't say everything. John said if I had to write everything down that Jesus did, the volumes couldn't fill the universe, the world. Because he can't say everything. So when those divisions, Matthew had a reason for the gospel. And we said that it was to portray to the world the Son of David, the coming King. And we will get back to that next week. So as we look at this, I want to talk about the greatness of the kingdom, and we're going to start off right here. What I call the great find. What makes the kingdom so great? Well, first of all, it's a great find. And when we look at these two first parables, and let me read those, and then we'll talk about them. In verse 44, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. Now get the picture before we really dive into this. Get the picture. Here is a man who is hired to cultivate a field. He's out there plowing this field, and boom, he hits something. And here it is, someone had buried their treasure, their dowry, whatever it was. They hid it in a field. This is not uncommon. And he comes across this. And I'm sure he's looking around. Kind of like when you slip and fall, you look around. Did anybody see that? He's looking around. He's looking around because he takes this and he realizes, whoa. This is an amazing discovery. I'm just out here working, and boom, there it is. So he reburies it. I'm sure he put a rock or something so he wouldn't forget. And then he goes and sells everything, buys this field. Maybe some of his relatives are like, wait, why are you buying this field? And then to find out there's buried treasure. Buried treasure. So then Jesus goes on and he says, and again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. This is a gems dealer. Someone who goes around and buys and collects to sell. Most likely to the wealthy, they're the only ones who could afford these things. When he found one of great value, you know, the pearl of great price, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. Here is a man, like the first man, was out just working. And he comes across this treasure. The second man was looking, always looking for something valuable. And all of a sudden, because he knows what is worth the money, he has an eye for it. Like people who are antiques collectors, or people who can just see something, and because of their experience, they understand, oh yeah, let me clean this up, and I will get a lot of money for it. But I'm not going to offer a whole lot of money. They have an eye for that. This man looking and he found a pearl that he knew would bring a high price. So he, again, like the first, sells all he can to get this. because he understands the value. So when we think about these two parables of the kingdom, we have to look at the two different people. This is one person wasn't looking and found. The other was looking and found. See, the great find. That's the kingdom of God. When someone sees the value. Now think about it. Some people, and I'll just briefly with me, some people like myself came across the treasure of Jesus unexpectedly. I wasn't looking for Jesus. But in the circumstances, God found me. He revealed himself. That hidden treasure, Jesus Christ. I wasn't looking for him, but I certainly found him. And a lot of other people can share that similar experience. But think of in Jesus' day, think of the prostitutes, the lepers, and the tax collectors who knew there was no Messiah for them. And then comes Jesus. Can you imagine how he rocked their lives, inviting them into his own home and him going into theirs? See, they knew there was no treasure, no kingdom for them, and here comes Jesus. Are you starting to get this? And then finally, I think in a bigger way, is think of the many Jews who didn't even expect Jesus to be like, or the Messiah to be like Jesus. What Jesus is saying, I believe, in these parables, is he's saying he was an unexpected treasure. Whether it was people looking for him or people who came across him, he was unexpected. He was the great find. Is your heart stirred by the treasure who Jesus is? Are you willing in this day and age, in however God moves in your heart, to make him absolutely the center and priority of your life? These parables were people who recognized the great value that they had found. I think after 2,000 years and in our culture, we take the treasure of who Jesus is for granted. We do. Some of us live in the past glory days. But what is Jesus, this treasure, this pearl of great price, what's he doing today in your life? He hasn't stopped being the treasure. He is ruling and reigning. Well, those are the first two. I think the greatness of the kingdom is the fact that it's a great find to stumble across the king and his kingdom. To find it. But I love the fact that in the second one, the man was looking. I mean, you think about that. He was looking. One of the greatest stories in my mind that captures this idea of finding the pearl, of being this gems dealer, and coming across something that just absolutely astonishes this dealer, this pearl of great price. I think I would say it would be the story of Simeon. Let me read that story. Think about Simeon. Simeon was an elderly man in the temple, and he, it says in the scripture, was looking for God's glory. But let me just read this to you. You can find this in Luke chapter 2. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. It had revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he would see the Lord's Messiah. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts when the parents brought in the child Jesus. So when Joseph and Mary walked in to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took the baby in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for the revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel." There's Simeon, a man who had been looking, and he is holding the pearl of great price in his arms. That is absolutely astonishing to me. And he said, "I can go in peace now. I can go in peace." He found the pearl of great price. Wow. So there were people looking, and there were people who gave up all hope. And yet, there's Jesus. There he is, the great find. And then there's the great catch. Think about the great catch, that parable of the net or the dragnet. Let's pick that up at 47. "Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up on shore. Then they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad away, the unclean, the inedible." This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. We get great insight into this parable because of the parable of the wheat and tares, right? It sounds very similar. Rather than the field being the world, it's the lake is the world. And the net is that great catch of the kingdom. Because Jesus has to rule and reign until the last enemy is defeated, and that last enemy is death. So we are that new creation, new life in the old. And like this great catch that catches all kinds of fish, the entire world is under the authority of Christ until the old age is done and the new age is born completely. Again, the great image that I tell all of you is the image of the rising sun. It gives light, but it is not completely up. The kingdom of God is here. Jesus is ruling, but it has not been completely consummated. And we, as salt and light, we are that new creation, that new life in the old. It won't be until the end when the angels, that's their job, not ours, to separate. Well, when I look at this, when Jesus is saying this, I believe that he is talking about the fulfillment of the promise to Abraham. Go back to the beginning of Matthew. He not only is the son of David, he is the son of Abraham. Israel is seen in in and through the whole ministry of Jesus. As the ancient father Irenaeus said, that all of Israel's history is recapitulated in Jesus. A fancy way of saying, look at the gospel. It is the telling of the history of Israel through their Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham, the son of God. So we have this great catch. Immediately our minds should go to the promise of Abraham. Let me just pick that up in Genesis 15. God took Abraham out and he said, look up at the sky and count the stars if indeed you can count them. Then he said to this old man who had an old wife, he said, so shall your offspring be. Look at the stars, Abraham, that you will be a great nation. And Jesus says the kingdom of God is like a great catch. All kinds of fish. And then immediately my mind goes to chapter 7 of Revelation, where John has this great vision of a great catch. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. What a great catch, folks. Right now, as I speak, nations, tribes, peoples, and languages are worshiping. In churches all over the world, 24/7. It is just amazing to me. Jesus is saying that the kingdom of God is this great catch. All kinds of people. What a mix. And there's coming a day at the resurrection when finally things will be sorted out. Sorted out. Well, a great find. A great catch is the kingdom and the king. And then finally, he comes to this last, where I call it the great treasure. Now he turns and he looks at the disciples specifically, and he says to them, and I would say to all of you, have you understood all these things? Well, it'd be kind of arrogant to say, yes, they replied. Because read the rest of the gospel. They did it. They did their best, just like we do, but no excuse not to dig in and work. Have you understood all these things? Jesus asked. Yes, they replied. And then this is what Jesus said. He said to them, therefore, every teacher of the law who has been instructed about the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. So he looks at the disciples and he says, you who have answered yes are like a wealthy person, a household owner, who can bring out of a treasure of their wealth, can bring out of their storeroom new and old treasures. The great treasure. See, being subjects of the king, we now offer the king's treasure to others. I love what Martin Luther, the great reformer, is known to have said more than once that he said, "We are all mere beggars, showing other beggars where to find bread." That's worth repeating. We are all mere beggars, showing other beggars where to find bread. Jesus uses great terminology. This is a treasure. See, we found a treasure in the field. We found the pearl of great price. We're among those in the net. We're part of the kingdom. We do say yes to Jesus. And now we have the blessing of sharing that treasure. There never comes a time where you're not sharing that treasure. And I love what he says, new and old. What does Jesus mean by that? New and old. New Testament, Old Testament. Stuff that I just bought that I gave away and stuff that's been sitting on the shelf. Oh, we're going to do a food collection. Oh, let me find that can of, I don't know, prunes. Wait, let me dust it off first. I'll donate that. Nah, that's not what he's saying when he says old. It's not what he means. Well, there's something, if you get anything out of this message, this is what I want you to hear, is that we need to understand what I call the correct direction. The correct direction. Now, men, I know that most of you have a hard time with directions, especially if your wife is telling you which way to turn. My kids and my wife finally got me GPS. And now, you know, phones, and you can do that anywhere. I know where I am all the time now. Not that I know where to go, but I know where I am. I want you to understand, if you don't hear anything else, hear this. It's about direction. When Jesus says that we have this opportunity out of the treasures that we had in the kingdom of being subjects of the king, is that we need to start at the resurrection. Easter is everything. Start at the resurrection. See, the resurrection is the fulcrum, it's the nexus, it's the matrix that everything turns on. When you start at the resurrection of Jesus Christ, because that changed everything, it is from the resurrection of Jesus Christ bodily that we look back and things begin to make sense. And we look forward and things begin to make sense. If you start back here and try to figure things out, you're going to go off on all kinds of crazy tangents, and world history will tell you what I'm saying is true. Start with the resurrection of Jesus Christ, then look backwards. That's what the gospel writers do. And then they look forwards. That's what the apostles do as well. When I say we need to understand the proper direction, that's what I mean. Start with the resurrection. Look, go backwards. Start with the resurrection, go forward. It's amazing how that will give you treasures old and treasures new. See, the resurrection, Jesus unfolds or unveils the old covenant and promises, the prophecies and the rituals. How else would we understand Isaiah chapter 53 if we didn't start with the vindication, the resurrection of Jesus, then look back to the cross? Now all of a sudden the cross has a meaning that we didn't know it had. Think of the disciples on the road to Emmaus. The disciples on the road to Emmaus are leaving Jerusalem after Jesus had been brutally murdered. The Romans were very good at saying, "We're in charge. Take a look." And they were distraught. They were grieving. The one who they thought would lead Israel into freedom and liberation and bring a revolution of a new kingdom is gone. And yet this stranger comes to them and walks with them. And he says, "Didn't you know that these things had to happen?" And it says that he unfolded the story of the Messiah from Moses through the prophets. And you know how the story goes, that he then revealed himself in the breaking of bread, and then he disappeared. I don't know how that works with a resurrected body. But the fact is we, because of the resurrection, we look back and things make sense. Then Isaiah 53, the suffering servant, all of a sudden makes sense. Jesus is the suffering servant. The cross is the greatest act of love. See, only God could turn something so brutal and violent and actually make it one of the greatest acts of love, or the greatest act of love ever. The Apostle Paul learned that. Many of us have learned that in our weakness, his strength is made perfect. So, treasures, both old and new. It's Jesus. Start with him. Stick with him. Keep your eyes fixed on him, the author and finisher of our faith, as we run this race, surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. Great cloud of witnesses. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
There we go. Not bad for United Brethren. I don't know about you, but I get excited about the fact that one of the greatest attested historical events of all time is the resurrection of Jesus. It's not a lack of evidence that we have. It's a preponderance of evidence that we have. We don't need to hide any more than the crucifixion was done in secret and the resurrection was done in secret. Stick with Jesus because he's alive. He is that great treasure. He is the King, the Son of David. He is the Son of Abraham, who is the great catch. And he is the Son of God, who is the treasure without, I mean, I guess you can't put a price tag on it, right? Inestimable? How do you say that? I'm not being very eloquent right now. Not that I'm ever eloquent. I just want you to see the greatness of the King and his kingdom. The greatness. Can you do that? See the greatness of the King. that you have sent your Son. And in doing so, you gave him up in great humility and love, that you might turn your good creation around. You haven't given up on us because you are a faithful God, and you haven't given up on your creation because you are a faithful God. Thank you for giving us this grace.